These fancy instant water freezing videos often come with the claim that to make this happen, you have to do it with hot, near boiling water. And I do not understand why. It makes no intuitive sense, it breaks the first law of thermodynamics, and it usually comes with some sort of hand-wavy chemistry explanation of something-something about hydrogen bonds, and that is not good enough for me. I need to figure this out. So I went to the Arctic and I set up an experiment. One room temperature glass of water and one near boiling glass of water to see which would freeze faster. Except it was too warm in the Arctic in February to freeze a glass of water outside. Fantastic. Instead, I asked George to try and do it in DC. And there it was cold enough outside to freeze a glass of water, but the colder glass of water froze first, like you'd expect. This supposed phenomenon, which I have so far failed to recreate, is called the Mpemba effect. And it is argued back and forth in the scientific literature of whether or not it is actually real. So I bought a freezer and we're getting serious. A very nice man dropped it off for me. I have a list of 7 different methods that I'm going to use to try and get the Mpemba effect to work. And if it does work, to try and figure out why it happens. The first thing I'm going to do is make ice cream. In the 1960s, a high school student in Tanzania named Erasto Mpemba noticed that his warm ice cream mixture froze faster than his classmates' cold ice cream mixture when they put them both in the freezer. A visiting scientist named Dainis helped him replicate his findings and publish them. Now, I could not replicate his findings in my own home freezer with my ice cream base, but I am eating fresh churned ice cream for work right now, so I'm not that mad about it. But I want to see if I can replicate exactly what they did in their paper. This feels like the most straightforward version of this experiment that I can do. I have a beaker with 50 mils of room temperature water. I'm about to fill this one with 50 mils of hot water, and then I'm going to put both into the deep freezer and see both which reaches 0 degrees Celsius first and which one has ice crystals first. So the room temperature water reached 0 degrees Celsius and has kept going down faster than the hot water, as kind of expected. But let's peek inside.
Ooh, not really ice crystals in either one yet, though.
Why are there not ice crystals in the one at 0C? Or the one at negative 2C? That's weird. Water is weird.
This is also interesting that they're both right around 1.3, 1.6. They were both at 1.5 before I opened the top. But the cold water beaker is the one that has ice crystals in it. And the warm water beaker does not.
I've been struggling to recreate their results, but they tested 6 different temperatures of water and they found a freezing time graph that looked like this. Now, Mpemba wasn't the first person to find a weird correlation between water's temperature and its time to freezing. Thousands of years ago, Aristotle noted that many people, when they want to cool water quickly, begin by putting it in the sun. And Francis Bacon wrote in 1620 that slightly tepid water freezes more easily than that which is utterly cold. I love both of those descriptions. But so far, I have been unable to replicate this. I have done this like 6 or 7 times, and every time the colder water freezes faster than the hot water. And it's not just me. The scientific literature goes back and forth on whether or not this is a real constant phenomena that happens in water, whether it is a weird quirk of water, or whether it is just something that happens sometimes based on odd external conditions. Either way, something weird is happening and I want to see it for myself. Here I have 20 beakers. 10 are filled with room temperature water and 10 are filled with boiling hot water. Place them in the bottom of this chest freezer and now we watch and wait.
When I checked on these, I did see crystals forming in the cold ones before most of the hot ones.
There are several hypotheses for why this effect happens, if it happens at all. One is that the hot water in the hot water beaker is evaporating, and so it's losing some volume, so it's easier to freeze a small volume of water in that beaker than in the cold water beaker. So this is something I can test. I'm going to weigh the water before and after freezing and see if the volume has changed significantly.
So this is kind of cool. So the room temperature one lost 0.3 grams during the trial, and the hot water one lost 2 grams during the trial. So I do think that a noticeable amount of water evaporated off of this one, making the overall volume of water that needed to freeze a little bit smaller. But I have not yet been able to get the hot water one in the glass beakers to freeze faster than the cold water one. So this is interesting, but not like Mpemba solved.
Another hypothesis is that dissolved gases in the cold water, which would be boiled off in the boiling hot water, would make a difference in how the two freeze. So the idea is that those dissolved gases could form little bubbles,
that would interfere with the crystal lattice structure of the forming ice, and that could lower the freezing temperature. So I have been using pre-boiled water for all of my experiments. Also, just to prove a point, I did try freezing both sparkling water and still water that had gone flat overnight. And for a moment, it did look like the flat one was going to freeze before the sparkling one. But then in the end, they both reached freezing temperature and crystallized at almost the exact same time. I am glad I controlled for this anyways, though. Another hypothesis is that hot water prevents an insulating frost from forming on the outside of the beaker.
So what I did is I took glass beakers and I wrapped them in styrofoam to insulate them, but I left the bottoms open. The one that started off at room temperature, it got down to like 1.7 degrees Celsius first, but it created those ice crystals on the top, and I think that insulated the top from getting colder. The hotter one did reach 0 degrees Celsius first, but it didn't freeze. There's no ice crystals in it. So here's the deal, right? That like, here are my two beakers in there. Oh. I think that when I just bumped into the freezer, this hot water one, I think when I bumped into it, it was super cooled water, so then it formed crystals. What does this mean?
I am not the first person to obsess over this. Scientists have been going back and forth about this in the literature for years. There was a 2016 review from the University of Cambridge that looked at the many back and forth studies on this, and they tried to list out the variables that were different between places where the Mpemba effect was seen and places where it wasn't seen. And so what they said was the variations between experiments include altering the nature of the cooling supplied, for example, insulating the base, submerging samples in cooling baths and radiative cooling, degassing or deionizing the samples, the addition of dissolved gases, and controlling or monitoring evaporation from the sample. Despite this wealth of experimental data, detailed analysis is typically lacking. Dang, Burridge in London. Other hypotheses that they bring up in this paper, which are some of my personal favorites, have to do with hydrogen bonds. Perhaps the heat allows the water molecules to overcome the weak hydrogen bonds that hold them together, increasing the amount of disorder in the sample, thereby decreasing the amount of energy it would take to cool the sample down. That feels questionable to me. But hydrogen bonds can contribute to some really weird water phenomena. This paper from 2024 found that by changing the orientation of hydrogen bonds in water, you can change how it conducts energy and heat.
In a simulated experiment, the scientists saw that when confined to small spaces, the water molecules have to organize themselves more neatly than usual. They saw areas where many hydrogen bonds would be oriented parallel to the tube, and areas where they'd be perpendicular to the tube. They found that aligning the intermolecular connections all in one direction doubles the water's ability to conduct heat in that direction.
And this could be super useful for building things like teeny tiny little cooling chambers for computers. However, back to Burridge in London. They looked at all of the studies that had been done over the years, and they plotted all of their data on one graph, along with data from experiments that they had done themselves. What they found was that the Mpemba and Osborne study was really the only one that showed this correlation that a higher starting temperature meant faster cooling of the water. What many of these studies were looking at was time to get to 0 degrees Celsius, and I don't have enough thermometers to do that for all of my replicates, but I have done a few replicate experiments of this so far. And in all of them, my colder beaker gets to 0 C faster than my hotter beaker. I cannot replicate their results. Some people have argued that even really small variations in where the thermometer is placed in the beaker can have an effect on the results. So let's get rid of the thermometer, let's get rid of the beaker, and let's get small. Really small. I have a cold piece of magnesium that's been in my deep freezer, and I'm going to put 10 microliters of water onto it and watch how quickly it freezes. There was a great paper last year that did this with an infrared camera to watch it happen super fast, and they found that the hot water did freeze faster at these small volumes, though when they went super small down to around 5 microliters, the effect disappeared. I'll be honest, I don't really see much of a difference on my little chunk of magnesium. Look, I could not get the Mpemba effect to work in my hands, and at this point I've tried about 15 different trials. But interestingly, the winner of a 2012 competition sponsored by the Royal Society of Chemistry that asked people to look into the Mpemba effect did see this in his trials. He did see that the hot water was coming down to a freezing temperature faster than the cooler water. Now, I graphed a couple of my trials of doing this, and I didn't see this. The Mpemba effect works first time for everybody but me. Maybe not everybody but me, but I just could not get my graphs to look like those graphs. He proposed that there was more convection in the warmer water beaker because the differences between the colder water at the outsides of the beaker and the warmer water in the middle, and then that movement of water inside of it could influence which beaker was freezing faster. He also pointed out that supercooling, which I did observe, might play a role if water supercools differently depending at the temperature that it started out at. And he calls back to a 1948 paper by Ernest Dorsey. Ernest Dorsey suggests that freezing, cooling, and prior temperature could all have an effect on whether or not water later supercooled and how it supercooled.
In that paper, Ernest Dorsey suggested that prior states, things like prior freezing and prior temperature, could affect when water supercooled and if it did supercool. But that's weird. How could the initial temperature of water affect what it does at a later point at a different temperature? Well, some scientists tried to investigate something similar using lasers and glass beads. Obviously. So they added microscopic glass beads to a water bath, and then they used something called optical tweezers, which are super cool. Optical tweezers are basically a really finely tuned pair of laser beams that you can use to hold microscopic particles in place. Now, they used laser beams to exert forces on those beads and create an energy landscape. And those beads falling down happens in two steps. The first step is that it falls from wherever you put it down into a valley. And then there's a second stage where it decides which of these valleys it wants to be in. So first step fast, second step a little slower. So for this system, the Mpemba effect would be when this second stage happens faster than in another system. So in the hot system, maybe a particle starts here or here or here or here. But in the warm system, not cold, but warm, the particles were confined to starting in, you know, smaller areas, right? They had to start somewhere closer to those valleys. Now, you might imagine that the particles that start down here actually reach their equilibrium state faster. So what they found was that in some finely tuned conditions, the hot system reached equilibrium faster than the warm system. So that, for them, was the Mpemba effect. So did this solve the Mpemba effect? No. No, it did not. This stuff is still confusing because water is weird. We've now seen other examples of the Mpemba effect in places where there is a quick drop in temperature and a phase change in places like polymer crystallization. Some studies have also seen a reversed Mpemba effect, including the glass particles and lasers one. This is where a cold system warms up faster than a hot one. There's also studies that are looking at the Mpemba effect at a quantum level, which is interesting. So is the Mpemba effect real? It seems like yes, in some cases, a hotter system can relax towards equilibrium faster than a cooler system. But it doesn't happen in every system, every time, under every set of environments, so it raises more questions. And just as we were about to release this video, a new paper about the Mpemba effect came out. Does it finally resolve all ambiguities in measuring relaxation speed in the Mpemba effect? It claims to, but it's kind of a big claim. It is really interesting though, because it's another example about how exploration into the Mpemba effect has moved past just water and ice and into like theoretical physics and like physical phenomena that happen in the world. Now, what mattered to me in my trials, what I was really looking at was when does it turn from liquid water into solid ice? Because I think if you're someone putting stuff into your freezer, that's what you really care about, right? You care about when it turns into solid ice. But mathematical models often define the Mpemba effect by looking at the shape of the curve of that cooling system or by measuring the relaxation speed by looking at measurements between discrete points on that curve. This paper argues that instead of investigating the effect that way, where there are like infinite possibilities of how you could decide to measure that curve and where you want to take the shape and what discrete points you want to look at, there needs to be sort of a way of looking at all of the different spots along that curve and measurements all at once to sort of get a measure of all measures of this system so that then you can define the Mpemba effect. They define this as the thermomajorization Mpemba effect, and they get very mathy and very technical to derive a way to actually quantify this in different systems. And again, it's very theoretical, but it's a way of looking for the Mpemba effect in the data rather than just looking at sort of discrete points and like me looking at whether or not it turns into ice. But more than anything, I think this study is really fascinating because it shows that an observation that a student had over 60 years ago making ice cream that many of his teachers told him he was absolutely wrong about, but that he went and found a researcher and together they proved that this could possibly be an effect. This has gone on to spur all of these discussions around physical phenomena in our universe, just like beyond water and ice, into other systems and other things that can happen. And I just think that that is pretty cool. I was... pun intended, Elaine made me say that. No, she didn't. I wrote that. I love a bad pun.